people hike through desert.
In arid regions, water is scarce. And in the dry season, villagers collect water from shrinking ponds. These are the sources of guinea worm disease.
Guinea worm is intricately tied to the problem of clean water because this is a parasite which is only transmitted by unclean water, water that has been contaminated by people who have these worms coming out of their body the year before.
It afflicted 3 or 4 million people in 20 countries or more, and no one else was working on it because the people who suffered from guinea worm lived in the most remote, suffering, disease-ridden parts of the world. If the worm comes out of a joint, say in your knee, it swells up and destroys the tissue. So the aftermath is very similar to polio.
The problem has not been the guinea worms. They are vulnerable. The problem is human beings. They have imagined all sorts of origins of this worm, attributing it to witchcraft, to people putting a curse on them, to a god or the gods being unhappy with them.
It's going to take a lot of health education to get these people to use the filters properly.
Vehicles ford a river.
There are no telephone lines, no electricity, and very poor roads.
The thing about an eradication program is that you have to get everything working right everywhere. All the time.
At the end of the day, it's the community that's going to be the ones eradicating the guinea worm.
Locals pour water through fabric filters, fade to black. Words read, and the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people. Numbers 21, 4 through 9.
Nyarfu.
At dawn, people transport buckets atop their heads.
Nyarfu nyala bam jaye.
Donkeys pull wagons loaded.
Nyarfu.
Words read, Global Health Frontiers.
Nyarfu nyala bam
jaye. A title appears over a moon pool, funnel water, fiery serpent.
Uye!
Let's fill cans and buckets
up. Carry
the containers away on their heads.
Shikurbe. Datirba.
Words read, narrated by Sigourney Weaver.
Nyarfu kulti tumaya.
This program was made possible by the John Moores family.
A microscope view.
The guinea worm parasite is a long, thin roundworm, Dracunculus medinensis, which only affects humans. But its life cycle depends on a small intermediate host.
In animation, a worm pokes from a foot.
The cycle begins when an emerging worm in a human host releases its microscopic larvae into a lake or pond. The larvae are swallowed up by tiny water fleas called copepods. Inside the copepod, the larvae continue developing for several days.
An animated larva grows longer inside a copepod's crab-like body. Now a boy drinks from a bowl.
And when another human drinks water containing infected copepods, stomach acid digests the copepods, but not the guinea worm larvae, which pass into the small intestine where they penetrate out into the body cavity. The larvae develop into adult worms as they find their way through the body, females mating with males which quickly die. The females continue to grow with numerous larvae inside them, burrowing into connective tissue or joints, absorbing nutrients from the human's body. About a year after the infection began, the worm is 2 or 3 feet long, yet the human host has usually shown no symptoms. But to complete its life cycle, the worm must release its larvae outside the human body. It does this by causing a painful skin blister, usually on a lower extremity like a leg or a foot. Burning with pain, the victim seeks relief by soaking the blister in water, and as it ruptures into an open sore, it exposes the front end of the worm. That's the signal for the worm to release its larvae, and its life cycle starts again.
Copepods snatch up the larvae. In Tingoli Village, Ghana, February 2007, Jimmy Carter shakes hands with a man wearing a colorful robe.
Former President Carter, America Zaha.
Later, the man sits in a large crowd and speaks to Carter and his wife.
He knows what support you have given to the community to fight guinea worm, and that for now, there is no single guinea worm patient in the community.
Since 1986, former U.S. President Jimmy Carter, his wife Rosalind, and the Atlanta-based Carter Center have led a global campaign to eradicate guinea worm disease.
The wonderful work that you have done here in Tingoli can set a good example for other villages throughout Ghana.
A plane flies over southern Sudan. The Carter Center technical advisor Tara Brandt interviews.
When I was flying from Nairobi, I remember looking at the clouds, and then as the plane started to descend, I looked out of the window and I saw just a few tuchels and then just land with nothing, and I got really nervous and I was like, what am I doing? What am I getting myself into?
A man that sticks together as the dance continues. A toddler walks with a tall, slender woman following a small herd of cattle. A man wearing medical gloves cleans a boy's foot. Another man bathes a woman's foot in a tub.
Has she seen the worm? Has she seen the worm come out?
Our term is technical advisor, but we do a little bit of everything on all levels.
Do they have the filter cloth here? Where is the filter cloth? But they are taking water and bringing it here.
David Stovelar.
So who cut this wound?
Scott McPherson speaks with a group of men.
Okay, so these men are going to hold the rope. Okay, that's going to measure. So tell them to just wait right here and not to go away. Okay? Good. And once you train these men, then you can come and get with them every single time, and you'll do it so fast. Okay?
Words read. Dozens of expatriate and local technical advisors work for the Carter Center in southern Sudan, assisting health authorities by managing guinea worm eradication in their districts. Stephen Kramer meets a local seated in a wooden shelter that he interviews.
I'm really happy that I get to see this part of the world. I think it's pretty unique to meet these people and to see their culture, which is still really strong.
Three white women dance with locals. In the background, structures spin off like acorn caps. Tara rides in the passenger seat of an SUV as it moves through waist-deep water.
Ever since I was about 13 years old, I really wanted to come to Africa and work with diseases.
She assists as a local wraps a boy's foot with a bandage.
Sometimes, maybe because I am young and I am a female, I'm not taken as seriously as I would be if I were a male.
She speaks with a group of men.
All right, we have...
Most of the men wander off.
No, I just wanted to make sure they were here.
Stefan chats with the group.
Hello. Hello, my friend. How are you?
They have a fairly specific and somewhat limited view of Khawajas, Westerners, white people, outsiders.
What does that mean?
You are burning.
I am
fire. You are burning.
I am burning. Because of the smoke?
Yeah, this one is fire.
Well, I'm not burning. I'm okay.
They don't expect you to be able to walk between villages. They don't expect you to be able to work hard or to wrestle or whatever it is. Just really normal things that I would take for granted. I think it's always hilarious when you go walking, going by footing from village to village, and without fail, almost every single person will ask the Dinka that I'm with, they will say, why are you letting this man walk? Where is his truck? Where is his motorcycle? And it's really funny, but it makes sense, because when they see people come, it's by plane or by vehicle or by motorcycle.
A lot of walking today. Every day, man, that's the Carter Center.
An advisor follows locals down a narrow path through a cornfield.
Juma. Hey, Juma. Man, if you want to rest, go work for polio.
Where?
You go work for polio, man. They sit around. They sit under the tree and wait for cases. Guinea worm, you have to hunt.
Well, it's very important that we send technical advisors from the Carter Center to monitor the progress
of guinea worm eradication in a particular country, because they need to go and actually see at firsthand what is happening in troubled areas where we know guinea worm exists.
It's going to take a lot of health education to get these people to use the filters properly.
This whole year has been really us learning what's actually going on, because the reports that we've received in the past, I don't think they were a really good representation of what's really been out here.
Words read, technical advisors are selected for their public health experience. They are not doctors, but they learn how to assist
with
extracting worms and bandaging wounds.
Just one.
A child lifts his bare foot. A white worm as thick as a spaghetti noodle sticks out below his toes. Kara observes as a local man wearing that gloves removes the ink-blocked exposed part of the worm.
Has it stopped? We don't want to break it, so.
Tears stream down the boy's face.
It broke. Make sure he knows. If it stops pulling, you have to stop and wait the next day. Because this is when they break.
If the worm snaps, it could retract back into the body and the wound will stay open, and that often leads to infection. The worm can also disintegrate within the body and infect the body in that way.
In Sabalungu, Ghana, several inches of a worm's body dangle from a child's foot.
So there have been multiple number of areas the worms have been, and they have been out, so it's just left with this one for them.
He's got one more still. So he's already had three coming out.
Yes.
And this one more. So he's got four out of his foot.
That not only was this disease terrible in nature, it afflicted 3 or 4 million people in 20 countries or more, and no one else was working on it, because the people who suffered from guinea worm lived in the most remote, suffering, disease-ridden parts of the world.
The guinea worm itself seldom kills, but in these poor communities, the consequences of this disabling and crippling parasite can be deadly.
If the worm comes out at a joint, say in your knee, it swells up and destroys the tissue. So the aftermath is very similar to polio. It completely debilitates that knee, and sometimes the leg is crippled for the rest of one's life. And of course, these kids can't go to school. The pain is too great and they need medical care. And if it's an adult, they can't go into the field to plant the crops. And it's a devastating blow economically, and obviously the personal pain is terrible.
Several people hold down the skin now as the worm is extracted.
Mama down.
The worm pulls free and the local advisor holds it up. It clings to his medical glove like a wet noodle.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a guinea one.
It usually cripples people temporarily, but for periods averaging between 1 and 3 months. And so that is how guinea worm causes its deadly effects. If the worm is coming out of the leg, they can't walk. If it's coming out of their arm or hand, they are unable to hold a hoe or farming implement. And when you add to that the fact that it's seasonal, so it comes right at the time when people need to harvest or plant their crops, and that up to 30, 40, 50, 60% or more of a village population might be affected at the same time, and individuals can have 1, 2, or even 3 dozen worms coming out of their bodies at the same time.
I realized that this thing from drinking unsafe water. When I went to the farm, my drink was empty of water. When I fetched firewood, I drank from any pool of water. That is where I got this thing. This thing is making me helpless. I can't grind for the children. Another woman,
And you have to remember that there's no treatment for guinea worm in medical terms. There's no vaccine. You just have to treat the disease after the people get the eggs in their body and the worm starts growing. That's when you have to start. So it's a very difficult thing to address.
How much more will it take? How long, 30 days or?
No, it's in about a week it should have been.
Another week?
Yes, at least then we'll then continue addressing the ulcer. until the ulcer gets out.
So one more week?
Yes.
When we first began dealing with guinea worm as a target to eradicate, we had no idea where it was, how extensive it was, or how hard it was to eradicate.
A world map.
The first step was to survey the world and to ascertain everywhere that guinea worm existed. And we eventually visited 23,600 villages, all isolated from one another, in 20 different countries. 3 countries in Asia, 17 countries across the sub-Saharan region of Africa. We had early success. In just a few years, we completely eradicated the disease in Pakistan, and we did quite quickly in India and in Yemen. But in some countries in Africa, it was much more difficult.
A counter spools down from 3 million as the outbreak from 1985. Now shots of warring troops and starving children.
For many years, we couldn't even get into southern Sudan to visit the villages to see where the guinea worm existed.
Words read, the second civil war in Sudan began in 1983 and lasted 22 years, destroying much of the southern region and displacing millions of civilians.
I went over there in 1995.
He meets with officials.
And I finally got them to agree after tedious negotiation to declare a ceasefire. And we still call it the guinea worm ceasefire.
Locals pour water through a cloth filter.
And it gave us a chance to go into southern Sudan as well as northern Sudan and visit the villages while they quit shooting guns at each other.
And then 10 years later, January 2005, when the political settlement was reached, the program was really began to get seriously organized throughout the southern part of the country.
Was the guinea worm pulled out, or is it still there?
Carter Center Director Ernesto Ruiz Teben speaks of a man. A thick patch of green material covers a sore on a man's hand.
He was detected on the 22nd of March, and this is June. So it's been like this almost 2 months. And this is not going to heal anytime soon. She's a village, one of 2 village volunteers. They have as duties being knowledgeable about guinea worm disease, being able to impart that knowledge to other members of the community, teach them what they need to do to prevent the disease, and maintain this record of the cases of guinea worm in the village.
Ernesto
this
Pages
book is also a history of the guinea worm eradication effort in this village. So it's very critical that these records are complete and exhaustive so that there is an accurate record of what happened here.
A Carter Center advisor.
We just did a quick a calculation of GPS coverage here in eastern Equatoria while we were talking, and it's at 76% overall.
There are 16 Carter Center technical advisors here and working hand in hand with Sudanese counterparts.
What we might have in the database sometimes may not reflect exactly maybe what the team in the field might have wanted to communicate.
Now, one issue about these mobile populations, honestly, as much as we know that the mobility of the communities in this area is a problem and it can create a sort of an illusion of where we need to focus. But that should not derail us from focusing on the villages, on the endemic villages.
In many situations, Mr. McCoy Samuel is the director of the Southern Sudan Guinea Worm Eradication Program of the Ministry of Health of Southern Sudan.
So, volunteers and area supervisors, let me just quote what my director general said, that we are facing a common enemy. Guinea worm is an enemy that should not be allowed to stay in our midst.
My country, Southern Sudan,
Southern Sudan, is very vast. And the long civil wars has made Southern Sudan one of the poorest regions in the world.
The infrastructure is terrible, which makes it extremely difficult to reach the remote areas,
which happen to be the most endemic.
What's the connection between Machi 2 and these other places? Why are people going back and forth?
Well, logistics is a huge element of this operation because all of the fuel, for example, and spare parts and whatnot have to be either flown by air, which is expensive, or by trucks over large distances during the dry season.
One of the things you do as a technical advisor and as well as the staff is move things around.
Technical advisor Tim Finn helps unload an airplane. Tara Brandt works with locals.
So we'll leave 4 boxes of pipe filters. So that's 4,000. These are Gauss pads. We need to take some to Tombeck and to Lingyi.
A truck speeds down a dirt road. A Sudanese man opens a box of pipe filters packaged in plastic.
It takes a lot of organization to get all the supplies out here, to keep the vehicles on the road, ordering parts.
A cargo truck leans as it navigates deep muddy ruts.
And things are constantly breaking or running out, so you've got requests from the field all the time.
A razor wire top fence surrounds a compound. Words read, from its headquarters complex in Juba, the Carter Center deploys staff, equipment, and supplies.
Southern Sudan is the most difficult place to work because there are no telephone lines, no electricity, and very poor roads.
Lightning flashes in a dark gray sky.
And most importantly, we have to do guinea worm eradication during the rainy season because that is the period during which transmission of guinea worm occurs.
Most of the socio-economic and health indicators in Southern Sudan are among the lowest in the world.
Also is the high illiteracy rate.
The other challenge also is the high illiteracy rate.
And ensuring that
any person with guinea worm doesn't enter water source. If people can do this very simple, and then we definitely protect ourselves from having the disease.
The signboard we have here, you can see this lady, she has guinea worm.
David, the idea
here is that there's a man saying don't go in the water. So this water source is responsible, so we believe, for most of the guinea worm cases around this area, because when you go to the houses immediately within this vicinity, the people all have guinea worm and they have high quantities of guinea worm. So we assume that this water source is responsible for most of those cases. This water source is actually a very famous water source in this area because you can see how it's shaded from the trees. So, and the water from here is very cool, so people like to come here to drink. They come from other villages as well. So that's a concern for us, that people from other villages are coming to get water here, and then if it's contaminated with guinea worm, they're then taking that contamination to another village. The flip chart is just a small cloth flip chart that we have, and it's just a tool that we use. We give it out to every volunteer and train them how to use it.
In a drawing, a woman gathers water.
It can be really effective because I think the people respond to the pictures.
In another room, a woman's man's leg.
So tell him to start away from the worm.
In 2007,
the program in southern Sudan reported 62% of the world's remaining cases of guinea worm disease, slightly more than 6,000 cases, down from more than 20,000 the year before.
Kids bathe in shallow water.
But outside this program, there were those who wondered whether these numbers could be verified. Were there many more cases in this vast region that had not been counted?
And one of the questions that surfaces time and again is, can we believe the data that's being reported by Sudan? Is this accurate? Are case reductions real?
A crowd gathers around a boy seated on the ground. Volunteers work to extract a worm.
The thing about an eradication program is that you have to get everything working right everywhere all the time. If any one of those things is missing somewhere or part of the time, you're giving this well-adapted worm a hole to go through and come up again next year.
21 years into the campaign, Guinea worm had been eradicated in all but 6 African countries. After starting with 3.5 million cases, there were now fewer than 10,000 cases reported, the vast majority in Sudan, and far to the west, in Ghana.
A map points to a small country on the coast, about a dozen people gathered by shallow water on a vast plain.
In arid regions like northern Ghana, water is scarce. And in the dry season, villagers collect water from shrinking ponds. These are the sources of guinea worm disease.
Villagers stand in water and fill paddle buckets. Helps another with a full bucket under her head. Contaminated graft gives, then climbs.
In Ghana, the guinea worm campaign had faltered badly. For years, the number of cases here had been declining. But now they had suddenly increased, jumping to more than 4,000 cases during 2006, with over 1,000 new cases reported in January 2007, just before President Carter arrived.
February 2007, Accra, Ghana, an airliner taxis, and the woman meets former President Carter. He meets with President John Kufuor.
Welcome back.
It's good to be back. Well, congratulations on your election.
Thank you.
It had been 3 years since President Carter's last visit to Ghana.
Things just spread, especially in the Savonugu township, where you couldn't find...
Are they doing that now?
No.
And on this trip, he was determined to find out why this was the only nation in West Africa where the fight against guinea worm was losing ground.
And this is a containment center? That's where you have...
That's where we are going.
Okay. That's good. How many of you have ever had guinea worm? Raise your hand.
I don't believe yet, from the top down, in the entire government and throughout the country, there's an adequate commitment to eradicate guinea worm.
President Carter believed that authorities in Ghana had lost their focus in the guinea worm campaign and were sidetracked by putting too much faith in expensive, long-term projects like deep wells to provide clean water.
Volunteers treat children lined up on a bench.
What was needed in Ghana, President Carter believed, was a renewed commitment to the same plan that had succeeded in eradicating guinea worm in other countries, a three-part strategy to break the guinea worm's life cycle by preventing it from reaching human hosts. The first part, educating everyone about guinea worm in every village that relies on contaminated drinking water, building awareness of how guinea worm is transmitted and how it can be prevented. Second, providing filter cloths for everyone to use before drinking any contaminated water, filters that remove copepods. And third, treating every contaminated water source with the mild larvicide called abate, that is harmless to humans, fish, and other creatures, but which temporarily removes the copepods that harbor the guinea worm larvae.
A teenage boy scoops water with a plastic cup and adds it to a pail.
A major cause of the sharp increase in guinea worm cases in Ghana was the breakdown of the water supply system for the city of Tamale. 30 kilometers away, the old pumps had stopped working at the pumping station on the Volta River. Without clean water from the river, people in Tamale and surrounding villages like Savalugu got the water they needed from local contaminated ponds.
Adam Weiss.
That particular outbreak, thousands of cases, mostly young children that were going to fetch water for their families. They would drink water at the dam side and then continue to transmit guinea worm. Because we're in one cultural area, people do migrate, and so Savalugu's outbreak started sending cases to other districts.
It was also clear that public education about guinea worm here was inadequate. People were not filtering water, and those who had guinea worm were entering and contaminating water sources.
Yeah, the people have not listened to the health education being delivered by the guinea worm teams here. So we realize that people have been wading into the water with their guinea worm. And the same place, all of them fetch water to serve the entire town. So that has been the problem of the outbreak. And it's also a big town. So once the source is contaminated, you have a large number of people being affected with the Guinea worm.
A donkey pulls a cart with a tank.
The new thing that we've seen this year is the water haulers who go to the ponds with their 50-gallon tanks and fill the tanks with filthy water full of guinea worm eggs and haul it to the towns, and the people, and unsuspecting people, drink the water. And it's just as bad as if they went to the pond and drank the water themselves directly from the pond.
Lids fitted with filters top a pair of 50-gallon metal tanks.
At collection points where people crowded to get their water every day, local authorities hired dam guards to stop infected people from entering the water and to make sure that water sellers with their donkey carts used cloth filters when filling their drums. But enforcing those rules under these conditions was not totally effective.
These water haulers are very politically important people who bribe officials of the government, and they make an enormous amount of money selling water, bad water, to the people. So that's something that we have to address.
As soon as the dam guard leaves this place, people are on their own, and they begin throwing the drum leads away, just fetching the water quickly to go and make money in the town. So they are in a hurry to make money. Than providing filtered water to the people in the town.
That is why it's making the work so difficult for us over here.
Hopefully, we can add Ghana to the list of successful nations. Others have done it, and Ghana is no special case. There are no difficulties here in Ghana that we have not experienced in many other nations.
Outside, the carters wear striped robes and march with locals.
Before President Carter left Ghana, he promised that the Carter Center would supply all the abate larvicide and filters Ghana required.
To prevent people going into the water source.
And authorities assured him that they would strengthen their guinea worm eradication program. The stakes were high. After years of work in progress, the entire eradication campaign could still fail. In countries surrounding Ghana, only a handful of guinea worm cases were reported. But if the parasites spread out of control and crossed Ghana's borders, the whole West African region was at risk of reinfection.
I'm fond of saying the problem has not been the guinea worms. They are vulnerable. The problem is human beings. The people who don't understand the parasite, who contaminate drinking water, who then drink contaminated water without filtering it.
They don't believe that
guinea worm is transmitted through water. They believe that is a natural disease in the blood. When you are telling them, please don't enter the water source, they cannot accept.
Women stand in deep water and fill buckets.
Guinea worm is different from other parasites in these areas in that it is, number one, only transmitted through humans. Many of the other parasites have other modes of transmission. But the fact also that guinea worm disease has this year-long incubation period between the time when people become infected and when the worm begins to come out has made it much more difficult for people in villages where this is occurring to understand where they're getting this parasite.
Somebody can tell you because of the way the cycle goes, every dry season, he or she gets guinea worm. He will tell you the thing is from the blood. So he thinks it's already in the blood, and a year later, it has to come out. But we are doing our best to explain the cycle of guinea worm, that it isn't that it's in the blood, but it's because you go back to the water, contaminated, drink it, 10 to 14 months later, it emerges again.
In Tarakaka County, Tara watches the treatment.
Does he know how he got guinea worm?
God gave him, God made.
God made.
Yeah.
God gave you guinea worm.
They have imagined all sorts of origins of this worm, attributing it to witchcraft, to people putting a curse on them, to a god or the gods being unhappy with them. And we have to be aware of and very, very mindful of the very, very strong traditional beliefs about this worm.
Yeah, actually, some years back, we really confused where this disease come from.
Right.
Is it coming from witchcraft? Because quarreling with somebody whom you don't know, the background.
Yeah.
And after a month or 2 months, then you get a guinea worm. You say, this worm, I get it from that guy because I'm quarreling with that guy.
Scott McPherson. A lot of the populace have just been completely neglected by education, by basic facilities such as water, things like that. And so when you tell someone to filter their water, they're not used to a classroom setting, they're not used to anything like that, and so you've got to be really creative with how you teach, how to use these interventions.
This is a conical filter.
This is a conical filter.
It's a polythene cloth, which is actually, used at the household level for filtration of water, especially from an unsafe water source like this. So with this one now, you see, because it has been exposed to direct sunlight, it has developed holes. There are already holes here. And they will continue to use this one, and they continue to have the false impression of protection. And the next year, when they had guinea worm, then they start to complain, I have been filtering the whole year. Why do I have guinea worm? And that's the problem.
I think people pretty much know what the filters are used for. It's just whether or not they're going to use them for filtering water. A lot of times you'll find people will have one filter for filtering water and then another filter used as a pillow or as a pouch for carrying things. So they're keeping ground nuts in here.
A lot of people use them to cover their bicycle seats. So we'll go through villages, and even the chiefs, they'll have maybe three of these layered, holding their bicycle seat together, so we have to take them off, destroy them, which sometimes makes them angry, but we explain the reasoning behind that.
The pipe filter had been a valuable tool in the guinea worm program here. It was modeled on those fashioned by nomadic Tuaregs during the guinea worm campaigns in the countries of the Southern Sahara.
The nomads who traveled around got a reed and tied a little tiny piece of filter cloth to the end of the reed, and every time they drank water, they would suck the water through that reed and the filter would take out the guinea worm eggs.
In Sudan, a man hands a woman a cigar-shaped pipe filter.
Millions of pipe filters and cloth filters had been distributed in southern Sudan, and there had been real progress in teaching people what causes guinea worm disease.
Manya.
In Tonge County, Manya. David Stokes
one pipe
woman.
Filter. They're gone. They lost them.
He said that it is because they said that they don't listen.
The children, yeah. They don't listen.
If it is
but
the
if
adults,
they are adults,
can,
they use them correctly.
Use them correctly.
Yeah, but the children are concerned with pipe filters. We give them to the children because they leave the home. And they go to tend to these goats and to the sheep, right? So I understand that the children, maybe they don't listen.
Yeah, they don't listen,
but
they don't take care of them.
But our job as parents is to teach our children. I want her to show me. Yeah. And then clean.
The most important thing is the community's understanding of guinea worm and the prevention of guinea worm. At the end of the day, it's the community that's going to be the ones eradicating the guinea worm.
In some villages in southern Sudan, chiefs and elders were reluctant to give full support to the eradication program.
They don't pay as much attention to guinea worm. it seems like they almost take it for granted in some way. And really, we're just trying to get out the message that we need good volunteers in our villages, we need people to use the filters, and we need people to stay out of the water when they have a guinea worm to break the transmission.
A man interviews,
when I see someone with a guinea worm bathing in the pond, I ask him why he's doing that. I tell him it's very bad that he goes into the water with the worm. He has contaminated the water with his guinea worm. It has released eggs in the water. Whoever drinks this water will also be affected by guinea worm. A man plays a 5-foot-long board bent into an L shape. Staff watches locals.
How many different villages do you think are represented here in this cattle?
Yeah, in more than 50 villages.
50 villages?
Yes.
Hundreds of cattle pack a camp. Cords reed. In the dry season, the Dinka herd cattle closer to shrinking grazing areas, assembling in communal cattle camps.
Going to a cattle camp is always a bit of a gong show, to be honest. It's always a bit of a mob scene. They've got the ash all over their body. And I think it's kind of a decoration and also to keep the flies off. And they also have the yellow in the hair, which is urine, cow urine.
A man watches a stream of urine.
So it's some unique fashion statements around here, but it's just how they dress themselves.
A young man slips a rope around the cow's neck, two cattle butt horns.
I think the cattle camps compound the problem of the guinea worm just because it just makes it so much more difficult to keep track of people. Because of this, the nature of this place, just the movement, the constant movement, people are always going back and forth between villages and cattle camp. And so they'll bring guinea worm wherever they go. And then it spreads that much quicker.
Dozens of locals stroll alongside Stefan.
It spreads that much quicker. And it's that much more difficult to keep track of it. So I think it's going to be one of our challenges is just start to include more cattle camps around here. It's a little more difficult than working in a village where you can just move from house to house and it's not so much of a mob scene.
Stefan touches a cow's long horn.
I like the cows, though.
Locals sing as they go, following the man during the scenes.
I believe these men have come to wrestle, and I'm not sure. I've never seen this happen before.
Dozens bobbing medicine.
I think they have invited me to wrestle.
Stefan removes his shirt and runs into the bar. He leaps high for a crowd of hundreds. A local ties a leopard print cloth around Stefan's waist. He and another man face off.
The chief came running out. And he put the kibosh on that.
Don't do that.
Don't do that.
Who can? Why not? You can. It is one of the criminals. You get the accident any time.
He what?
Why not? Going to wrestling with someone, you get the problem. What happened?
Ah, it's good. No, it's good. That guy would have kicked my ass. I think I would have wrestled, but I'm kind of glad that I didn't have to.
In fast-moving footage, people gather water at a muddy pool. Some fill buckets while water haulers top off their steel drums. Words read Tom McDonough. Technical assistant Amelia Taya interviews.
It's a great feeling that we are reaching the end, but it's much more difficult. In the past, you go out and you know that you are going to find cases. Now you go and you look and you look and you don't really find the cases.
Where was it?
A counter spools down from 4,000 to 500.
In the 2 years following President Carter's visit, Ghana's government had strengthened its campaign against guinea worm under the leadership of the program's head, Dr. Andrew Seydou Korkou.
I mean, 2006,
2007, we had this setback because of a breakdown of the Tamale water system. We had a very big increase, very huge increase in cases. But we managed to weather the storm, manage the cases, and the results are very significant reduction, about 85% on the average, which we have never achieved in the history of the program.
Our emphasis is on surveillance.
Our emphasis is on surveillance and case containment. We want to find every case. and prevent it from contaminating water source.
In a village, a volunteer pulls a used filter from a clothesline.
So when we enter communities, we're looking for any signs of potential transmission that we may have missed. Maybe the surveillance system wasn't as tight or as strong as we thought it was, and a case slipped in.
At this late stage of the campaign, with cases of guinea worm becoming scarce, an essential part of the strategy was community surveillance.
A man fills out a form as he speaks with villagers.
Health workers and volunteers going house to house, checking for suspected new cases, and making sure that families were using filter cloths to make their water safe to drink.
And when is the last time she checked the filter?
I knew that devait aller avant.
And it's important they understand, even a small hole, the copepod, they can't see it with their eye. Mm-hmm. And it can go through that hole.
People from the high school and come away.
This boy has got guinea worm, and he's fetching water. Chart. So I want you people to tell me what would have happened if he had gone inside the water with his guinea worm.
The objective is to create the awareness with the school children. We want to make them all understand that we are all responsible for eradicating guinea worm.
Somebody told me that guinea worm is nyerfo in Dagbani. But can someone describe what guinea worm is like to me?
It looks like snake and then quite small.
What I want them to do is report cases. Help us do surveillance. Keep an eye on the community. Create the awareness. Make them understand that everybody is responsible for eradicating guinea worm.
Responsible for eradicating guinea worm.
Drum kill.
Yeah.
You will get the toll rather than these three.
A counter of Sudan cases cools down from 6,000 to 3,600.
Okay. Within a small area of houses, people will always know who has guinea worm. So if you hit most of the small areas of houses when you're walking around, then you should basically find out about as much of the guinea worm as is there.
In 2009, technical advisors and field officers in southern Sudan conducted active surveillance in more than 10,000 villages.
It's still coming.
Did my end's warm? It came out? Or did he cut it?
A boy speaks in Tonj County, southern Sudan.
One worm has come out.
But has he seen the other worm?
No.
It's just suspected case.
Man,
why don't you come with us?
The boy slowly walks away.
Tell him I'll carry his stalks. Man, but.
The boy carries a trio of 10-foot-long stalks over his shoulder. He walks away from David Stobelar.
Mayan. He's refusing. Mayan has a wife. She's about 10 years old. So last time we treated and we removed his worm, he didn't cry because he didn't want his wife to see him crying.
The pumping station on the Volta River had finally been repaired, and many residents in Tamale were once again able to get clean drinking water from the pipe system. But thousands of others in the area still depended on open water sources, where guinea worm could be transmitted.
There's a complete behavior change. At first, there was reluctance. There was hesitation to agree with us, because people traditionally believe that guinea worm comes from blood. And it's in this last year that they've had the revelation that, no, guinea worm really is in the water, because, look, we stopped entering the water, we're still filtering the water, and now nobody's attacked by guinea worm.
At the water's edge, women stand on machines like ellipticals. They hold onto a handlebar and pump pedals with their feet to force water through filters.
They use it for agricultural purposes, but last year it was introduced into our district to be used for guinea worm prevention. They are there to prevent the people from wading into the water. They have tied filters to the outlet, so when they are pumping, it's filtered. And when they use it, even their water lasts longer because they don't have to walk inside and then turn the mud.
Water pours from filters into buckets.
We've really convinced people that if you do your job and filter your water, we'll do our job and make sure your water sources are protected.
Scott McPherson with locals.
So in the water right now, there are those copepods. You saw when we measured the water, right?
Yeah.
You saw all those things swimming around, right?
Yeah.
So what we're going to do is we're going to put this medicine in the water. Mm. It's going to kill all those copepods, okay?
An essential part of protecting water sources was repeated dosing with the safe larvicide Abate, at every water source that could possibly be infested with guinea worm.
So the very first thing we're going to do is get what's called an approximate length and approximate width.
A process requiring tedious measurement of water volume and calculation of the exact amount of larvicide needed to be effective against copepods.
Every 28 days, you have to come back and treat again because the cyclops grew up again. So the dam can be treated, but people still need to fruit that because somebody can come with guinea worm after the treatment, step inside to contaminate the water, so people still need to fruit that.
Pull the rope and make it straight. And who is going inside the water, Daniel?
There's a crocodile. Crocodile lives in this water. But normally, they are in most of the water sources we treat. They are not vicious at all. But when they are hunted, we have problems with them. This particular one, I think they tried it, they caught it, and it escaped again. So I am hoping that it will not really worry us.
A man floats on an inner tube to take measurements.
1.7, it's...
Local treat guinea worm sufferers.
It just takes one kiss.
It just takes one case to go somewhere and contaminate a water source.
And that's why it is very important that we need to eliminate that source. Because it is these people with guinea worm that creates a problem. It is not the unsafe water source.
So, I want her to show me then how to do.
You can sit down with them and discuss guinea worm, explain to them what guinea worm is, or they can even tell you what guinea worm is and tell you how they got guinea worm and how the water gets contaminated. But then they'll tell you that they've been bathing in the pond.
A volunteer shows local shelter.
You have to continue to remind them, don't enter the water, and you have to get the village volunteers every day when they bandage the case to do health education.
The challenge here is really to make sure that the communities understand their potential in ensuring that interruption transmission is realized in these communities. We cannot do it. We can bring all the filters we have on this world here. Yes, but at the end of the day, some people have to use it. People have to prevent it from entering water sources. We are too few to ensure that everybody in Guinea worm is prevented from entering water sources. But the community can.
As 2009 drew to a close, most advisors and volunteers in Ghana's guinea worm campaign were convinced they had almost stopped transmission, and that within the next year, the number of reported cases each month would drop to zero. Programs in neighboring West African countries reported similar progress, and there was a rising expectation that the parasite was on the verge of extinction in the region. For impoverished millions in Asia and Africa who still have no access to clean drinking water, guinea worm disease is now only a distant memory.
People walk across a dry plain. A tangle of branches forms a fence around a village.
But in southern Sudan, the territory's vast expanse was far too great to know for sure that all cases of guinea worm had been discovered and contained. Sporadic civil unrest was a serious concern, and at any time, new outbreaks of fighting between North and South, or between rival Southern factions, could shut down the campaign in wide sections of the country.
Our first priority is to keep people safe, and we're not going to compromise that in the name of going after guinea worm. And so what we try to emphasize is when there's peace in an area, be as effective as you possibly can, so we reduce this thing as quickly and as thoroughly as we can when we can work there. And I would say unequivocally that the Insecurity in southern Sudan now is the greatest single obstacle to eradicating guinea worm disease.
The only choice for the advisors and volunteers in Sudan's campaign was to follow the strategy and keep working.
Carter interviews.
Are you still confident that guinea worm will be eradicated?
There's no doubt in my mind at all.
I want you to carry these around your neck.
Stephen Kramer.
It's really encouraging to see them engage with us and just to understand that they can make a difference themselves.
A local volunteer adds treatment to a pond.
It is likely that Sudan will be the last place where guinea worm is eradicated from.
Can they promise that they are going to take care of these filters?
A woman helps another hoist a bucket onto her head.
President Carter wants this program to succeed, and he's put a lot into it. And I really want us to stop transmission and to eradicate guinea worm so that he can see this done. And
this fight is not over until the very last worm is gone. One worm could bring the whole epidemic back.
Following the victory against smallpox, guinea worm is likely to be the next disease to be eradicated, the first parasitic disease to be eradicated, and the first disease to be eradicated without the use of vaccines or medicines. Cases in Ghana, 2011, zero.
This program was made possible by the John Moores family.
Credits roll. Producers Gary Stryker and Walter Biscardi Jr. Director and writer Gary Stryker. Funding for video description provided by the U.S. Department of Education. Video description by Ken Max, www.yetchamax.com. Video description by Adam. Global Health Reference.